Sorry, that was the second one again. Third one, is this or is this not the Beatles?
Just please, please, oh, don't keep it from the kin. I need to hear the colours red and blue and the whispered word to fly off.
Right, have we got any comments indicating that people recognised any of those three?
There's a lot of comments there, Neil. People are actually very divided on this about whether they are or not. Yeah. CJ says one yes, two no, three no. And right, Loz says she's only heard of two of them.
Right.
Loz, is You Know My Name one of the songs? Or sorry,
yes,
I'm not.
The one, and it's relevant to what I'm going to talk about, basically, because there is a lot about the Beatles that's known. The marginal stuff is lesser known. The first thing you heard was You Know My Name, Look at the Number, which is the B-side of Let It Be. So that is a massive selling record, albeit not one that's being greatly played on the radio. The second one is the Beatles, the one that sounds like the Shadows. It's a song called Cry for a Shadow. It's recorded by the Beatles before they joined Parlophone. And it's unique in the entire Beatles catalogue as the only Lennon-Harrison composition that they ever released. And it's been officially released by the Beatles. It was unofficially released by the Beatles in the early 60s because Polydor had a handful of recordings of the band before they were famous and signed to EMI. The recordings of Cry for a Shadow have subsequently come out on official Beatles stuff because they're on the anthology recordings. The third one is a track which has got various names on it. It's actually the work of somebody called Robert Hunter, but that only became apparent when he proved it in 2021. Prior to that, the song, which has a, like I say, it's got a few titles on it, but it's most well known as Peace of Mind, Peace as in the opposite of war, or it's also known as a song called The Candle Burns, and it's turned up on Beatle bootlegs. So a lot of people have mistaken it for the work of the Beatles. The story that was widely believed, but which is not true, is that it was dug out of a dustbin around the back of the Apple headquarters on Savile Row, and therefore was a demo that was just ditched by the Beatles. And some people thought it was by a band that was auditioning for that. Actually, it was a purpose-built distraction. It was a couple of Americans were involved in doing it, one of whom was the gentleman I mentioned earlier on. And they actually did it almost to sound like a Beatles outtake. So even if you think you know the Beatles, there's a lot around the margins that you don't. And my talk tonight is basically about Beatles myths and legends. So that's my book on the left-hand side. But it touches on all these myths and legends that you're looking at. So John was assassinated to order by the US government, which is quite a widely believed conspiracy theory. Paul died in November 1966 and was replaced by an imposter. Much lesser known, George Harrison died in late 1973 and was replaced by an imposter. So he's the one Beatle who's died twice. Another myth is that Ringo Starr got very lucky joining the Beatles and there's nothing remotely interesting about him, which is just not true. And then there was also, and I'll go into this with three particular examples, a belief that they didn't split up. They announced their split, but actually the Beatles were recording as a band, as a four-piece band or variations thereof until John Lennon died. So we'll go through them all in order. The last time I gave this talk, I gave 20 minutes of this talk, and it was got to be one of the most bizarre webinars I ever did. The entire audience was booking secretaries for various WI branches in the southeast of England. And they were auditioning me to see whether I was a fit and proper person to talk to the WI. I've subsequently got a booking in Sussex on the back of that. But I was a bit conscious when I did the talk that it starts off dark and then gets gradually lighter. So because I only did the first 20 minutes, I talked about the death of John Lennon, which seemed a pretty heavy subject for the WI, but they cope with it quite fine.
Just please,
sorry, we'll move on. John Lennon. So this, I think, is probably the best known of all the conspiracy theories about the Beatles. John Lennon was assassinated to order. That's the conspiracy theory. You'll find a book written by a British barrister and academic called Fenton Bresler that actually argues exactly that. And the main pillars of this belief are the bullet points there, basically. John Lennon was a known radical. He'd got a track record of championing people who are underrepresented, left-wing causes, people on the margins of society, particularly the kind of political mavericks that were associated with the beatniks, the hippies, the yippies, and people like that. And also he championed the cause of workers' rights, which was more of a thing in the UK than it was in the United States. From 1972 to 1980, when he was killed, he was a resident of the United States, and he'd applied for full citizenship over there. So one of the things that has had people believing that he might have been assassinated to order is that had he become, as was very likely in the summer of 1981, a full-blown American citizen, he was less likely to be worried about being deported and consequently might have become more politically active. And he hadn't recorded, he'd had five very quiet years. I mean, he'd been doing things, he'd been writing songs and he'd been involved in business, and he'd also been devoting a lot of time to being a father because his youngest son was born in 1975. But he was back recording again in 1980. And at the same time as John Lennon re-emerged from his self-imposed recording exile, Ronald Reagan got elected as president of the United States, replacing Jimmy Carter. By presidential standards, Jimmy Carter was quite liberal. Ronald Reagan was completely the opposite. He was actually quite right-wing by Republican standards. And the conspiracy claim is therefore quite simple to understand. Some people claim that the CIA were preparing for a right-wing move in the country. Ronald Reagan's policies were, to a certain extent, known ahead of time. What became known as Reaganomics or monetism in this country was already being prepared as a policy to go forward. And John Lennon potentially re-emerging as a major cultural force was a threat to that. So there are books about this, and there's quite a lot written about it. These are the sort of pillars of whether John Lennon might actually have been any kind of threat then, okay? Literally a week after the day that he was assassinated, John Lennon was already committed to taking part in a march for Japanese American workers in San Francisco. The person organizing the march, or one of the organizers to be precise about it, there are a number of them, was Yoko Ono's cousin. So the Lennons, all three of them, including Sean, had agreed to attend it, all right? And it would have been a significant re-emergence into public activism. I mean, apart from anything else, they were going to fly from one side of the country to the other because they lived in New York, so they were flying to San Francisco for this, okay? It is quite likely that John Lennon would have got his full citizenship. When he first went to the United States and tried to settle there, because he had a drug conviction, he, technically speaking, the Nixon administration was then in charge, were not interested in him staying there. They were quite happy for him to visit, but there were moves to get him deported and not become a full citizen. He had a lot of active support from significant intellectuals, artistic people, people on the left wing, Democrats, in political Democrats. That would have been less of an issue had he become a full citizen in 1981. He would have had the same rights as everybody else. And the FBI, despite his 5 years of relative inactivity and no public activity, the FBI had a very long and detailed file on John Lennon's associations, the people with whom he'd been associating with regard to radicalism. They knew he was friends with quite a lot of the leading hippie radicals and associated people, and he'd stayed in touch with a lot of them. So potentially he was a threat, all right? He'd given financially, and he'd supported causes in the past. So he'd supported getting certain people out of jail. In 1972, he made an album that's not greatly critically regarded these days, but the Sometime in New York City album is full of political activist songs. It's full of people, you know, it's full of commentary on the political situation, and it's not very favorable to Richard Nixon, the then Republican president. All right. Another thing, which seems like a minor thing, but it's significant to why the FBI, CIA, and other people might have been worried about John Lennon, was simply that whilst he'd been inactive as a recording artist from 1975 to 1980, the Lennons, as in Yoko and John, had become massively wealthy in that period. One of the things that had gone on, and this is mainly Yoko Ono's doing, was that they'd spent a lot of time investing and managing money. And when he died, he was exceptionally wealthy, quite possibly the wealthiest Beatle. It's difficult to tell between him and Paul McCartney. But some of the things that the Lennons had invested in were seem bizarre now, that if, apart from anything else, for example, John Lennon and Yoko Ono owned some of the most valuable cattle in the United States because they'd been very astute investors. So potentially he was quite a threat, because if he'd come back to radical activism, if he'd come back to espousing a lot of the causes that were not favorable to the Reagan regime, he actually had the financial means to stand up and make things happen. Right. This is the gentleman who this is Mark David Chapman, who shot John Lennon, fatally shot John Lennon. So if you believe the conspiracy theory, then we need an assassin. And I've put Manchurian candidate in inverted commas. I'm assuming that I'm speaking to ASSAP here. So I'm speaking to a lot of well-read and knowledgeable people. So I probably don't have to go too much into the way that you might brainwash an assassin and create a Manchurian candidate. But there are arguments, certainly in the more convoluted conspiracy theories and in Fenton Bresler's book, that Mark Chapman was such an animal. And there's circumstantial evidence to suggest that that's possible. It's interesting because I've only had one lot of dealings with Mark Chapman. He actually wrote to me, but not until way after my Beatles book came out. So there's no mention of it in the book. And he didn't really say a lot other than to send me a lot of religious literature. So he's certainly somebody who can be persuaded to follow a cause and to be very dedicated in doing so. And like I say, he wrote to me refusing to comment on what he was thinking when he shot John Lennon or anything else, but suggesting very strongly that I follow the same Christian denomination that he now follows. His history, and we haven't got time to go into the whole thing, but I've got the second bullet point there suggested that he's rootless, and he drifted in and out of jobs over the years. He could have gone to university. The woman who would have been his mother-in-law at one point, he was engaged to somebody but broke that off and married somebody else. She commented, and it's widely reported in Fenton Bresler's book and various other books on the subject, that he was actually quite bright, but he just didn't really stick to, didn't follow it through in terms of the amount of work he put into, you know, passing university courses and whatever. However, he was dedicated to work in the Presbyterian Christian missions that he went to. One circumstantial piece of evidence that's used to support him as a programmed assassin is that Mark David Chapman pleaded guilty when he was charged with the murder of John Lennon. Consequently, he's never been cross-examined in court. There's no question he shot John Lennon. There's eyewitness reports. He didn't flee the murder scene. He gave absolutely no resistance when the police tried to arrest him. And he claimed that it was the will of God that he was doing what he was doing. But of course, it's never been tested in court. So whether his testimony would indicate that he'd been brainwashed or whether his testimony would indicate he'd made those decisions, we'll never know. I'm assuming that ASSAP members would be familiar with the deaths of Harold Bloor and Frank Olson. This is significant because the conspiracy theories around the notion that John Lennon was shot to order suggest basically that American security services were brainwashing people from the 1950s onwards. Harold Bloor was a former tennis professional. Frank Olson was a scientist. Both of them died in 1953. Both of them were dosed involuntarily with LSD. And those were the early days of a program known as MKUltra, which you can Google. But there clearly were attempts to interfere with people's brains and to see if they could be persuaded to do things against their will. Now, that's a long time before Mark Chapman shot John Lennon, but the conspiracy theories suggest that this was something that the security forces had been involved in for a great number of years, okay? And also, if you're looking for Manchurian candidates, you often want people who, well, psychologically speaking, the evidence suggests that you want people of high intelligence who've not settled to causes and aren't focused on any other goal. therefore can be persuaded to understand something very complicated and carry it through. Ran over on the Manchurian candidate. So let's look at some other bits and pieces here then. Now, normally when I'm giving this talk live, we'll have a bit of a discussion about who we're looking at and what these people actually mean. I'll rattle through them quite quickly here because they're all relevant to this case in one way or another. And my suggestion really is that I don't think that there is very strong evidence that John Lennon was killed by the American state. I think actually that if you start looking at some of the other things that were going on, you can knock great big holes in this argument quite quickly. The pictures of Todd Rundgren across the top. One of the arguments about Mark Chapman's reasons for shooting John Lennon are that he thought John Lennon had first of all become a hero to him, and then at that point he thought John Lennon was a phony, and he was reading Catcher in the Rye. Mark Chapman was reading Catcher in the Rye when he was picked up by the police. In fact, after shooting John Lennon, he sat down and read Catcher in the Rye. And if you're familiar with the novel, a big part of the novel is the main character Holden Caulfield's notion of people being phonies, insincere. And the argument about the conspiracy theory says that Mark Chapman saw John Lennon as a phony, insincere person. And that was based on a book called One Day at a Time, which was written about John Lennon's time a few years before that in New York. Well, yeah, it's a great theory. But what is not in dispute from the eyewitnesses who knew Mark Chapman for many years is that Mark Chapman's all-time musical hero was Todd Rundgren, the guy at the top. And he owned more Todd Rundgren music than the music of any other artist. So Todd Rundgren remains alive and well. Todd Rundgren was not living very far from New York. If Mark David Chapman was that bothered about flying from Hawaii to kill somebody, it would not have taken him very much longer to get to Todd Rundgren's house. So if he was having some kind of breakdown where he couldn't dissociate his musical hero from himself and was therefore capable of killing them, Todd Rundgren would have been a much more likely candidate. The person on the bottom left, I'm sure I'm telling half the audience at least to recognize James Taylor, but the American singer-songwriter James Taylor, there's an interesting little item of information that came up but did not come up in the police investigation of the shooting of John Lennon, but came up randomly later when James Taylor made a comment to an interviewer. James Taylor lived one block away from John Lennon, so he used the same subway station as Mark David Chapman used to get to John Lennon's Dakota apartment building. And shortly before, as in like a day before John Lennon was shot, James Taylor had a very strange encounter as he came out of the subway, because James Taylor, despite being a very famous musician, was quite happy to use public transport in and around New York, and frequently came out the subway station and just walked to his apartment. And he met a somewhat deranged individual who sort of stopped and harangued him in the street. James Taylor felt very threatened, a little bit uncertain about this person, and kind of made his excuses and left very quickly and thought nothing more of it for a little while until he saw pictures of Mark Chapman. And James Taylor's convinced he spoke to Mark Chapman. What James Taylor said about the conversation was that he described Mark Chapman's conversation as, in inverted commas, freak speak. That the guy wasn't making a great deal of sense. So we don't know whether James Taylor had a lucky escape and could have been on the end of Mark Chapman's bullet or whatever, debatable. But circumstantially, Mark Chapman appeared to be a threat to somebody's life, at least a day before he shot John Lennon. David Bowie and Neil Young. Well, Neil Young's had quite an eventful year already, hasn't he? Just a comment I would make. If the United States were bothered about immigrant rock stars being a threat to young people in 1980, I just wonder why John Lennon was such a threat. The music he was making in 1980 on the Double Fantasy album was amongst the most middle-of-the-road things he'd ever recorded. Unlike David Bowie, who was a New York resident off and on during this period, was influential on the more out-there kind of youngsters of America, and had one or two aspects to his personality and his work that was quite threatening to middle America. not least of which was the kind of androgyny of the whole thing. And without going into raptures about Neil Young's work in the late 1970s, Neil Young is not American, people think he is, but he's Canadian by birth. In the period in which John Lennon was recording Double Fantasy, Neil Young, as an immigrant, was making quite anti-American music off and on. His Rust Never Sleeps album, without going into all the details on it, includes a side of furious electric rock. There's a song on there called Sedan Delivery, which is probably about drug dealing, and it's about the economy of America to a certain extent. And there's a song that he's... Neil Young fans have a love-hate relationship with a song called Welfare Mothers, which is either ironic, which I think it is, or meant sincerely, but it's basically about America's underclass and the sexual morality of the single mothers in the United States. And it's got a cracking refrain on it called that says Welfare Mothers Make Better Lovers. The point I'm making is that Neil Young has often made political comments in his songs. Prior to John Lennon being shot, he just released an album called Hawks and Doves, which is very much concerned with the politics of the United States and is not particularly supportive of Ronald Reagan's ideas, although he subsequently came more round to that. But the point is, Neil Young continues to live, breathe and work, and the CIA never seemed to take any interest in assassinating him. Okay, so I would suggest that there may be reasons why we should doubt the conspiracy theory that Mark David Chapman shot John Lennon on the orders of some masters in the security services. Okay, first of all, at the time that Mark David Chapman shot him, he only owned one John Lennon record, and it was Double Fantasy, and he'd only just bought it. And the reason he bought it was because he joined other fans of John Lennon who were waiting outside the Dakota building in New York, because these diehard fans of John Lennon knew that John Lennon was recording. So they frequently saw him come out of the building, get into a limousine and go to the recording studio. And he was quite approachable. You know, he would say hello to them and whatever. Mark Chapman owned them. The Double Fantasy album was recently released and it was out, but a lot of these fans who were the most dedicated were saying to him, well, if you think you like John Lennon, why haven't you bought the new album? But that was the entirety of Mark David Chapman's John Lennon collection at the moment he shot John Lennon, right? Similarly, there is another detailed book about the killing of John Lennon called Let Me Take You Down. It's based on interviews with people, and it takes a totally different line on Mark Chapman. It suggests that he was having psychotic episodes, that his ability to distinguish real from fiction was, to say the least, compromised. And that his act in killing John Lennon was almost like a desperate need to do something that mattered. And supporting that, I guess, is the fact that when David Chapman set out to shoot John Lennon, he actually intended to do this. I mean, he left a hotel room, a very cheap hotel room, and in it he set out a little display in the room, so knowing full well that he was going to get arrested and that the police would go back to where he was staying and just search his belongings. And it was a rather pathetic little display, which included a Todd Rundgren tape. It included a letter attesting to Mark David, like a reference, basically attesting to the good character of Mark David Chapman. It was almost like a desperate attempt to say that he mattered, and possibly, I mean, quite likely, in fact, that it was an attempt to say that he mattered from somebody who very much doubted that he did. And he clearly intended that he was going to get noticed, and he clearly intended that some of the act of killing John Lennon was to do with Mark David Chapman actually becoming somebody in the act of doing that. And that is, that I think is easy to assume, because after shooting John Lennon, he remained on the scene of the shooting. He saw the police arrive. He saw the medical team. John Lennon went to hospital in a police car, but he saw everybody come out and try and help in the situation. And when the police actually got hold of Mark Chapman and asked him, did he know what he'd just done? He said, yes, I've shot John Lennon. So he clearly expected that he was going to get picked up. He clearly, he made no attempt whatever to escape. He, whatever he was thinking or not thinking, whatever reasoning was going on, part of the reasoning clearly included the fact that he personally was going to be arrested for this, that people would notice what he'd done. I'm going to take a breath at this point. If Chris wants to come in and raise any questions or comments, we can do that. It gets a little bit more fun after this.
Hi there. So at this point, hang on. It's been quite heavy so far, isn't it? We've been going through the... Can you hear me?
I can hear you fine, Chris. That's a superb hat and conspicuously different to the one you had on before.
They do change throughout the evening. I mean, I remember as a teenager reading the book published by St. Martin's Press, which suggested that he was a Manchurian candidate, that he was trained by the CIA while he was a YMCA officer living in Hawaii, I believe. Who wrote that book?
Yeah, that sounds very much like the book I was talking about, Fenton Bresler's book.
That's it. It was Bresler's book. Yeah. I wasn't actually, at the age of 13, I wasn't particularly convinced. No. And the reason I wasn't particularly convinced was I thought that there would have been other ways to prevent, there were much more radical figures in the American landscape at that period. And also, intelligence services rarely go around whacking out domestic troublemakers. I mean, even though you might think that Martin Luther King and some of the victims of 68 were assassinated, generally speaking, it does seem to the lone lunatic theories tend to win out.
Yeah, but yeah, John absolutely. Lennon,
I mean, you know, a conspiracy to assassinate John Lennon? So many people love the Beatles. I find it hard to believe. Don't know. Well,
and also, you know, whether John Lennon hadn't proved himself to be a threat to social order, although he'd not given up on the friendships with the various radicals, whereas somebody like Neil Young, although he was less of a musical force in the sense of, you know, I hadn't got the profile of John Lennon, there's no question. You've only got to Google the lyrics of Welfare Mothers Make Better Lovers to see that he's coming from a completely different point. If there are no comments or anything like that that people want me to respond to, I'll get onto the wacky story of William Campbell Shears, i.e. the guy that's had the solo career claiming to be Paul McCartney.
Sounds good. Billy Shears.
Question, can I just interject? I don't know whether this would be better suited at the end or now that we're talking about John, but Roberts points out that he did send money to support striking dockers. Is that right?
John Lennon?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yes, it is, Robert. And that's the thing I mentioned. The demonstration he would have attended a week to the day after he was shot dead. These are striking workers in San Francisco, including dock workers. And that was the labor dispute that Yoko Ono's cousin was helping to organize. And John Lennon was already supporting it. And there's no question. I mean, the FBI never closed the file on him. The FBI were very well aware that in the 5 years of recording and public inactivity, John Lennon had actually become much richer than most rock stars in that period. He'd moved his money and he'd used it very well, rather than just going out and making more albums and touring. So he was in a position to support anybody that he wanted to. You know, him and Yoko were exceptionally wealthy.
And on that basis, Dave Sivier says, wasn't he also involved in putting together a benefit album for the Oz defendants?
Yeah, absolutely. And there are some very interesting bits and pieces that you can listen. I mean, obviously, all this stuff you can hear these days, you can hear even the stuff that wasn't released. Sometime New York City has there's one live side and one live album and there's one studio album. Yeah, John Lennon had used his, musically speaking, he'd used his celebrity and he'd used his contacts to, you know, to do quite a lot of things. Some of them well-known and some of them less well-known. But people like Angela Davis, who was a prisoner and a radical in the early 1970s, yeah. He supported her coming out of jail. And he was, you know, he'd met people like Jerry Rubin, who were, you know, the leader of the Yippies, i.e. the political wing of the hippies, basically. So
yeah.
He was associated with these people. Yeah?
But, I mean, you look at Grace Slick, Paul Kantner. I mean, Grace Slick actually wanted to take a grenade. She got an invitation to the White House. Because she went to school with Nixon's wife and she set out there but was recognised as being Grace Slick by the security service, who didn't let her in, even though she actually had an invite. I mean, Kantner was up to his neck in radical politics. You've got as, like, not to be confused with Doris Day, but Dorothy Day, who was the head of the Catholic Worker Christian Anarchist group. Mm-hmm. She was a far greater threat to the state than John Lennon, though nowhere near as famous. There were so many radical groups from the Diggers all the way through that I just can't see Lennon. And 10 years before, at the height of the anti, I mean, immediately after the kind of Vietnam protests, the period when Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young are singing Ohio back in 68, Tin Soldiers and Nixon's Coming, We're Finally on Our Own, This Summer I Hear the Drumming for Dead in Ohio. I think, you know, they would have been bigger targets by a long way than McCartney.
Yeah, exactly. A Neil Young song. So my point entirely, and I mean, whatever you make of Neil Young's actions this year, 76 and he remains a radical. So Neil, as we sit here today, Neil Young and Grace Slick continue to breathe. So I think that people were prepared to believe a conspiracy theory. I don't think the evidence actually backs it up when you look at that closely. Okay, oh, should we get to William Campbell Shees then? All right. So Paul McCartney, the first serious Beatle death rumour actually is Paul McCartney. And again, there are books written about this. There is a wonderful book, if anybody is listening in tonight and really wants to get to grips with this. Whilst it's a long time ago now that the book was published, I would greatly recommend a book called The Great Beatle Death Clues, which is about the death, in inverted commas, of Paul McCartney, right? William Campbell Shears, Billy Shears. The story is crudely this. It's an inconsistent story in the sense that when you start to look at the dates and the times and whatever, they various versions of the story contradict each other. But at the heart of it is the notion that Paul McCartney died in a car accident or possibly a motorcycle accident in November 1966, and that he was replaced by a guy called William Campbell Shears, who may or may not have earned his place because he came in the top three in a Beatle lookalike contest. And most of the conspiracy notions on this one suggest that William Campbell Shears was Scottish. Circumstantially, the evidence that backs this up is the fact that Paul McCartney died and the Beatles never toured again. So consequently, the gist of the various versions of the story suggests that there was far too much Beatle business and far too much value left in the group for them to split up. They realised that, well, they apparently realised that faced with a dead half of the main songwriting team, they couldn't really go on. So the decision was taken by Brian Epstein, who may or may not have been killed to keep him quiet, that the band would continue, but clearly they couldn't fake it on stage. But when they were in a recording studio, they could continue to be the Beatles. Subsequently, William Campbell Shears was brought in as the new Paul McCartney. And as you can see from the on the left of the slide there, right, you'll find various things online suggesting that when you look very closely at the facial features of Paul versus William Campbell Shears, you can spot the difference. Debatable, frankly, and I'm not aware that anybody ever took a DNA sample from Paul McCartney pre-1966, so I don't know that we'll ever prove this either way, but this is the story anyway, and it's featured over the years in a number of places, including the magazine that you're looking at there. It was briefly, and I mean briefly, as in a matter of weeks, it was major world news. All right. Life magazine actually thought to investigate it, albeit they didn't investigate it very much. They went to the Mullah Kintyre. One of the things that kept the story alive briefly was that Paul McCartney was away from London and actually wasn't particularly available to anybody. These were in the last days of the Beatles. The Beatles were still an ongoing act, but to all intents and purposes, they weren't a working musical act. They in 1969, when the death story became big news, albeit the rumours had been going around since 1967, but we'll come to that in a minute. In 1969, when the story became world news, that the band had got together again to record Abbey Road. So I'm assuming I'm talking to people who know some of this, but just in case you don't, the recent fun and games about the Get Back TV series. It's based around hours of film made in early 1969 when they came together to try to do something different. They didn't want to use their usual producer, George Martin, and they were in search of a big artistic project. But they came together in a studio in Twickenham and tried to almost invent that from scratch. And that's what's in the Get Back film. But in reality, that was the second last album they recorded, but the last album they released, it was such a disaster in terms of listening to the record, they hadn't got what they wanted, albeit it's an interesting TV series, that they reconvened later in the year in Abbey Road and recorded the album that's known as Abbey Road. But other than that, they weren't touring, they weren't in each other's pockets, and Paul McCartney, who was married that year, had got a farm on the Mull of Kintyre, which is quite remote in Scotland. He'd recently become a father. So the picture you're looking at there is Paul, his stepdaughter, and his newly born daughter and his wife, Linda. But they were living a very remote life away from London, away from the rock scene. So it was quite easy for rumours to spread because he wasn't being seen every day in St John's Wood, which a couple of years ago was a fairly regular occurrence. A couple of years before that was a fairly regular occurrence. The various things that stoked the conspiracy theory, without going into all of these in detail, there's loads of suggestions which you can find online saying that the albums from Sergeant Pepper onwards are absolutely dripping in clues, that there are things to do with the alignment of the word Beatles on the back of the Abbey Road album cover. And that if you see on the right there, you can have some fun and games with the on the record cover of Sergeant Pepper, if you put a mirror up across the middle of the drum. It appears to reveal that Paul McCartney died in November. If you use the American reading of numbers, it appears to give away the date in November 1966 when Paul McCartney died. And the Billy's Back, the memoirs of Billy Shears, that's a much more recent production, that book. But it's part and parcel of the ongoing fun and games, and to some people not fun and games but actually genuine belief that Paul McCartney was replaced by an imposter. All right, so stories behind the story here. Well, a few things to say. So my take on this, and if you like, the reason I'm talking about this to ASSAP, is that you're critically minded, you're the Association for the Scientific Study of Anomalous Phenomena. Let's get stuck into social science for a minute. This has all the hallmarks of an urban legend. And first and foremost, if we look at the most convincing evidence that Paul McCartney didn't die, I think it is improbable, to say the least, that you could get somebody who was second or third in a lookalike contest in Scotland, and that person could so successfully become Paul McCartney that it's largely seamless. Yeah. To put this into context, at the end of the 1970s, the three most successful recording careers in the history of the music industry were Elvis, the Beatles, and then Paul McCartney outside the Beatles, i.e. Paul McCartney's work with Wings and solo work or whatever. How the hell you parachute somebody who simply has a physical resemblance to a musician into that position, and within 10 years or a little bit more than that, they've become so successful that they've actually sold more records than Led Zeppelin or Pink Floyd, is somewhat bizarre to say the least. My take on it would be the following, really, that I think pre-internet, we may be... It's easy to lose sight of some of the things that would fuel this. First and foremost, if you're old enough to remember this period, which I'm not really, but I'm old enough to remember just after it, a lot of people spent a lot of time smoking stuff that was not legal, listening to albums and talking a load of bollocks. And in the process of doing that, often if you were brought into that whole way of socializing by people who were older than you, you were told stories. So I was talking with Christian before we came live here, for example. I grew up in Carlisle. Nobody played Carlisle. So consequently, on the odd occasion that anybody that you'd ever heard of actually turned up there, you'd go. And there was a number of regular people that you would see at we all went to every gig because there weren't that many gigs. So if I'd grown up living in London, I'd never have seen Hot Chocolate, Smokey, or whoever. Yeah, I would have still gone and seen AC/DC. But because you got to know these people and they were older than you, they would say to you, well, that was great, but you should have been here when Black Sabbath used to play regularly, or you should have been here when Jimi Hendrix used to play regularly. The point I'm making is that cultures develop around certain things. I would suggest that one of the main things that stoked the Paul is dead belief, and actually the George story I'm going to tell you later on, is that these things make a hell of a lot of sense if you're stoned and listening to albums and the door's shut and there's a handful of you around the stereo. Circumstantially, then, you can look at certain things and you can see that, you know, the evidence appears to be there. And if you're persuaded in that moment, then the argument that you're being persuaded into will make a bit of sense to you. So, for example, this is an outtake photograph in the middle here of the shot from the famous iconic shot of the Abbey Road cover, where basically the four Beatles in that order that you're seeing there walked back and forward across the zebra crossing until the photographer had got the shot. One of the beliefs around the Paul is dead argument is that the costumes of the various Beatles give away what's going on. And therefore, John Lennon is dressed as a preacher. Ringo Starr is an undertaker in his sharp suit. Paul McCartney, who's got sandals on in this picture, but he's barefoot in the iconic album cover, is the dead body, and therefore he's shoeless. And George in his double denim is the gravedigger. All right. Well, you can believe that. Alternatively, they maybe just turned up looking like that, knowing that there was going to be an album cover shot that day. All right. The gentleman in the bottom left-hand corner is a guy called Russ Gibb. I put my glasses on it because I can never remember the name of the radio station that he worked for. But and you know what? It's not on my crib notes. Oh, yes, it is. Sorry, my mistake. WKNR-FM in Detroit. Russ Gibb he died a couple of years ago. He was a DJ who, more than anybody in the United States, started talking about this particular idea on air, and consequently, if you like, took a lead role. It was almost like he was more than just the guy in the room listening to the stereo telling me this. He was the guy that was actually putting this out on air and giving it some official blessing. And we wouldn't be doing this justice unless we also took on board the fact that one of the things that happened to make this belief more widespread was that people started hearing clues in the records. By far the most famous is the notion that if you play Revolution 9 backwards, i.e. the piece of music Concrete that's on the final side of the double white album, if you play it backwards, you actually hear the words, you hear them saying, "Turn me on, dead man," referring to Paul. So I'll play it backwards and forwards. This is the actual clip that is pertinent to that.
Number nine, 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 number nine.
Meanwhile,
number nine, number nine, number nine.
I'm convinced now, I'm assuming, yeah? To be fair, Paul McCartney's had fun with this. The photograph you're looking at the bottom right there is Paul McCartney on the same zebra crossing many years later. There is an album, a live album by Paul McCartney called Paul is Alive, where he's on that zebra crossing and he's being dragged across it by a sheepdog. And the sheepdog is actually one of the descendants of his famous sheepdog, Martha, as in the dog to whom the song Martha, My Dear is dedicated. Right. I'll move swiftly along to George Harrison. Then we might have another break to see if there's any questions. This is probably the least known of all the Beatle legends, but while I take a sip of water, if you want to have a look at the news story, this came from Sounds, the British music paper, long out of print, of course, but in 1976 Sounds reprinted a story that first turned up in America, and they even printed the address of the person who was making the claim that George Harrison was dead.
I had now that's when I'd never heard that George Harrison was dead. That is quite shocking.
Well, he is dead now.
Well, he is now, yeah, but it's a bit late.
I'm just giving people a second to read. I mean, if you've registered that, I'll go on, Christian. I'll stop at the end of this one, okay? And then we'll have a chat about Ringo and the various bands that weren't the Beatles but were the Beatles. Yeah, if that's okay.
Fantastic. Yeah. Okay. Good. There's a load of questions.
I was just going to say we have quite a few bits coming in about Lennon, McCarthy, and everything. So if you want to take it after the next chunk, or if you want to take it at the end, there are quite a few comments. So, yeah, if you want to carry on, that's fine.
Yeah. I'll take it after George Harrison, if that's okay. That's how I normally do it when I'm doing this live. Simply because the George and the Paul one, the reason I will do this, so apologies if I'm keeping you waiting with a question. The reason I will do this is that I think I'm about to demonstrate to you that the George and the Paul story are the same cultural phenomena, but they've gone in very different directions for quite understandable reasons. In other words, effectively, what I'm saying is that the critical thinking that drives ASSAP will help us to understand this for what it is rather than what it claims to be. Okay, so I'm not making this up. Sounds reported it as part of the Department of Silly Rumors, and Sounds took a great delight in doing this. And in the following weeks after they'd published that in early 1976, which they'd taken from an American source, Sounds also took delight in the gossip columns in reporting sightings of George Harrison and discussing it. They had a bit of fun with it. But this is the interesting thing. The original story, and if you've got just the gist of that from the opening paragraphs, then Claudia Gates, who was the woman who was reporting this, had a particular take on George Harrison's death. She said George Harrison had died. She was unspecific about the date, but it was late 1973, early 1974. He'd suffered more pain than any human being alive because he died horribly of cancer, which, I mean, in reality, the real George Harrison did die of cancer. But the other interesting twist on this claim was that not that he'd been replaced by an imposter a la Billy Shears, although clearly he had been replaced by an imposter, but that the dead George still existed and was in telepathic contact with her, Claudia Gates. I'm assuming that one or two of you more critically minded people, the alarm bells are already ringing. I don't recall this becoming a big story. I do recall people talking about this. I recall joking about it on the school bus because, if you know, I was a young music fan at the time, and we read the music papers avidly, particularly out in the sticks. If you wanted to really get into music, you had John Peel's radio show and the other late night radio one. You had what was written in the music press, and you had the occasional gig. So there wasn't a lot to go at. So you absolutely devoured everything that was on offer. And subsequently, I've written up this story for a number of magazines and in the Beatles book over the years. And one of the things when you look into it, although Claudia Gates' take on it is that George was existing in some kind of spiritual realm where he could communicate with her, but apparently very few other people. When you actually look at the circumstantial evidence around the dead George, it's very similar, although it's not a big part of the legend as it was first reported. It's very similar to Paul. If you assume all this really happened, so therefore the album covers and the songs will be absolutely gushing with clues. Well, in actual fact, perversely, they are. The last record made by George Harrison, i.e. the real one, if he died late 73 but was not alive in the early months of 1974, there is no question. The last record made by George Harrison, album length record, is Living in the Material World, which is an interesting title for an album because isn't that where we all live? Why would you draw attention to the fact that you're living in the material world unless you might be on your way some other place? So you're looking at George Harrison album covers here in the middle of the slot. That's the front of Living in the Material World. That's George Harrison's hand, a Kirlian photograph of George Harrison's hand. The detail below it is from the inner sleeve of the album, and it's George Harrison. I'll show you in the next slide. We'll have a look at the whole big picture. But basically, pay attention to the fact that he's in colour. Everything else around him is in black and white. It's almost like he's ascended. He's more aware and more alive in some ways than everybody around him. The first album, I'm not claiming this is true, but do me a favour here and suspend your disbelief for a second. If he was replaced by an imposter, the first album made by the imposter is Dark Horse, i.e. the title of the album means I'm not who you think I am, right? And it's an album absolutely dripping in spiritual references on the cover and one or two songs on the actual album as well, up to and including the fact that the front cover is a still photograph showing George Harrison as a boy. But it's been, as you see there, it's been defaced to put various bits and pieces of meaning in there, including references to the Hindu faith, the Hare Krishna branch of the Hindu faith that George Harrison supported. All right. That's the back of the Dark Horse album there. So that's George Harrison on it. Above it is detail of the Dark Horse front cover. And it just so happens that George Harrison is back row, absolutely in the center of the back row. And again, his face has been, the coloration on his face suggests that he's different. He's in some different state to everybody else. The picture on the right-hand side is the gatefold inner sleeve picture from the last album made by the living Harrison. Now, tell me, am I kidding myself here? Or is that just a pastiche of The Last Supper, the famous painting of The Last Supper? Yeah. With Harrison as Christ in the middle, i.e. he's about to die and he's about to go some spiritual place that the others aren't going in any hurry. And not only that, but without labouring the point, the detail around it references birth and death. So in the background, you've got these huge old days pram and everything like that. One thing I'm frequently asked when I'm doing this live is that George Harrison's house? i.e. is that Friar Park Henley on Thames? No, it was shot in Los Angeles, actually. But if you suspend your belief for a second, then he just seems to be giving it away, right? i.e. the clues are there. And not only that, but rather like the Paul is dead, the clues are also in the songs. The last number one George Harrison had, i.e. before he died and was replaced by an imposter in the United States, was a song called Give Me Love. And it includes this line, give me life, keep me free from birth. All right. Well, literally speaking, if that has a meaning, it's somebody who believes in reincarnation, which in his faith he did. And he's facing death and he's begging not to be reborn in a physical form. All right. i.e. the kind of sentiment that somebody aware that he's about to die might actually articulate in a song. Okay. Right. The Living in the Material World album also includes a song called Be Here Now. Oasis lifted the title because they're big Beatle fans, but the Harrison song includes the line, now is be here now and it's not what it was before, i.e. maybe his physical state is changing, right? And also the Living in the Material World album, the last song on the last album recorded by Harrison before he died in inverted commas is called That Is All. Okay, it gets a little bit more complicated, but not too much. So the first releases by George Harrison, i.e. if the Dark Horse George Harrison, i.e. if you believe for one second he's replaced by an imposter, depending on where you were, it was a different record. So in the United Kingdom, the first release was a single called Ding Dong, right? Which is so repetitive that when Sounds, the music paper, reviewed the Dark Horse album, the title of the review was Ding Bloody Dong. And Ding Dong includes the words right at the start, ring out the old, ring out the new, ring out the false, ring in the true, i.e. basically, you could read that as, well, George is gone, I'm here. Yeah, right. In the United States, the first release by George Harrison in 1974 was the title track of the Dark Horse album, which was released as a single, which actually, it's the one song that appears on both official George Harrison Greatest Hits compilations that's not a significant hit, because Dark Horse didn't even hit the top 50 in the United Kingdom. But it does include the line, "I'm a dark horse running on a dark race course," i.e. quite literally, he's saying to you, "I'm not what you think I am," right? The subsequent album to Dark Horse is an album called Extra Texture, and it includes a song called The Answers at the End. And again, which appears to reference, if you read it a certain way, references is being replaced, the George being dead and being replaced by an imposter. Yeah. And that line comes from it. "Now I only want to be with no pistol at my brain, but at times it gets so lonely, could go insane." In other words, it's almost, if you want to read it a certain way, it's almost as if he's drowning, basically. You could read that as the imposter saying, "I wish I hadn't done this. This is too much." Okay. I'm not saying I believe it. I'm simply saying that if you line the evidence up a certain way, it looks very much like the Paul McCartney legend. Yeah. It's a belief system. It's a belief you could come to from the circumstantial evidence, at which point you start digging, and where you look with a bit of confirmation bias tells you you were right all along. Okay. A little bit of a coda on this, and then I'll take any questions, and we'll think about Ringo and the Beatles coming back under pseudonyms. I never met a Beatle. I got bloody close to meeting George Harrison, and I would have loved to have met George Harrison. Frankly, for my money, he's the most interesting Beatle. I won't bore you with all the reasons why I think this, but I wrote this story up, this George is Dead story, for a magazine called Dodge, which was sort of halfway between Private Eye and the Fortean Times, I think, in the early 1990s. And I was at work one day and I got a phone call from a researcher on the Jonathan Ross show, which is why Jonathan Ross is in the bottom left-hand corner looking like he did in the mid-1990s. The gist of the call was, would I go on Jonathan Ross's show and repeat what I just said in the Dodge article? Because at this particular point, I was writing about George Harrison on for various things. I even included it in an entry I wrote for the Rough Guide to Rock, which was a rock encyclopedia, claimed to have been written by fans, but a lot of the fans, when I met them, that wrote that book, were very much like music journalists. I agreed to it, but it was not quite as simple as that. The plan was, and they explained this to me on the phone, the plan was quite simple. They wanted me to go on there and talk about this article that I'd written, and Jonathan would you know, do his best to sort of lean forward earnestly and say, "Well, you sure about this?" At which point, I was going to be in on the secret, but clearly the audience weren't. The plan was for George Harrison, i.e. the real George Harrison, to walk out behind me and deny that he was dead. And the point of this was that he was then going to announce a European tour. And he would say, "Well, you know, I'll prove you, I'm not, I'm going to get back up there and sing the songs." And this was because he only ever toured twice in his life. And this was because there was a plan then for him to go and tour Europe, which never actually came off. So on the right-hand side, you're looking at a Live in Japan album, i.e. The second and final tour that George Harrison ever did as a solo artist. He toured America behind the Dark Horse album, actually, and then he toured Japan with Eric Clapton's band, but he wasn't a great live performer. And in the end, he decided not to do the European tour. So consequently, the thing with Jonathan Ross never came off, and I'm disappointed to this day that I never actually met him, because it would have been an interesting moment in my life anyway. The other thing he was doing at this particular point, which he was going to talk about, was he was supporting a political party called the Natural Law Party, who took an absolute pasting 30 years ago in the British general election. They stood candidates all over the country and lost deposits everywhere. They were a new age party. We haven't got time to go into it, but if you want to Google what they continue to believe, what they believed at the time, what the manifesto they were standing on, you think that they put that argument up against John Major. It's chalk and cheese, absolutely. So in conclusion, before we take a few questions on this, I would say that my take on this is that urban legends, and I'm look, we apart from anything else, I've got the head honcho of the folklore podcast listening in at the moment, so I'll be brief on this because he knows a hell of a lot more than I do. But urban legends take hold when there's a reason for them to do so. The thing with Paul McCartney, there were a number of things driving that, not least of which was the fact that it was just a lot of fun and it drew so much attention to the Beatles. The Beatles didn't step in and stop it because they were selling more records on the back of it. There is no way, for example, of getting statistics of how many vinyl albums were destroyed in the act of trying to play them backwards, because your best chance of hearing backwards vinyl in 1969 was to literally push an album backwards on a turntable. Well, circumstantially, that must have happened, because when Abbey Road came out, the previous albums followed it up the charts, and this coincided with the Paul is Dead rumour. By complete contrast, I would argue that George Harrison's stock, both critically and commercially, in the mid-1970s was waning to the point that actually there was no need for that to take on board as an urban legend, because he was part of a generation of pop stars who were being replaced by the rock stars of, you know, David Bowie and people like that. And what explains the George's Dead rumour is quite simple, really, that Living in the Material World is the last of the songs that he had pre-prepared when he left the Beatles that were likely to make good solo albums. His style changed because he started recording in America with different musicians. His voice is absolutely shot on the Dark Horse album, so he doesn't sound that much like himself, because he's rehearsing for a tour and recording an album at the same time, and he's, vocally speaking, he's not in the best shape. And he was starting a type of music that was lambasted in some press circles as country and Eastern, where he was getting, you know, his spiritual beliefs were taking a different form on the albums. And frankly, a lot of diehard fans were disappointed to the point of walking away from him. And that's borne out in his chart positions. And like I mentioned earlier, the Dark Horse single was conspicuous. It was the first solo single he released in the United Kingdom that did not make the charts. So I would take Claudia Gates' view on this. It's almost like she's a fan who's desperate for George to still matter, and she's come to a very convoluted reasoning about why he doesn't. Okay, rant over on that. I'm going to have a sip and answer some questions.
Thanks so much, Neil. What I'm going to do, if it's okay with you, I'm going to put in some input from the chat that we've had. And if the people responsible for asking the questions would like to phrase them themselves, that might be much better than me. But okay. If not, I'm happy to say them out loud. So Tony Hayes, are you there at the moment with your question about Lennon and the USA and the anti-war stance?
Yeah, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you.
You're buzzing a bit. Your UFO is hovering quite a way away, is it?
Yeah. Try again, Tony.
Yeah, is that any better?
Great.
Yeah, that's better. Go ahead. Do you want to make your point?
Yeah, also, this is about the John Lennon one, was it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It was just really an observation that his anti-war rhetoric with the Vietnam War was the reason why he didn't get an extended visa to get back into the United States. Mm-hmm. So that was really just an observation rather than a direct question.
It's a good observation, and it does go to part of the conspiracy thing, which is that, you know, that he was certainly persona non grata to certain people in the United States. The Nixon administration didn't want him there. The reason that he ended up staying there was because there was so much public support among, as I mentioned earlier, academics, democratically inclined political people, and, you know, various other conspicuously public figures like Norman Mailer, that it was very difficult to throw him out. Richard Nixon wasn't thrilled about him being there.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I don't think we're that happy in this country with it, neither, is it? He did his famous bed, it was called the Bed for Peace, self demonstration, and was encouraging other Americans to do the same. So he would have been bad news to the likes of the United States. So I can understand why they didn't extend the visa.
An interesting point about why the conspiracy theories continue, Tony, is that all that you've just said there is a matter of public record, and it's still easily discovered on the internet. So if you're that way inclined and you want to line up the fact in a you know, confirmation bias way to say that John Lennon genuinely was assassinated rather than shot by somebody who was very disturbed, then you can line it up. Yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. I don't believe for a second that he was assassinated by the CIA. The guy, you know, he convicted the right guy. Yeah, I'm with you with that one. Okay, thank you.
Okay, cheers.
Dave Sivier, are you there, sweetie?
I'm there.
Hi there, hello. You say some of the rumours about his death are clearly rubbish. Are you, you're talking about Paul there, or we've moved on to Paul?
Yeah, talking about Paul McCartney.
And about I Am the Walrus. What is it about I Am the Walrus?
Well, yes. There's a book called Rumour, which talks about some of these rumour legends or urban legends.
Yeah.
And one of them is, and it talks about the, you know, the stories about how Paul McCartney, you know, has died and been replaced by an imposter. And I think part of the evidence some people were reading was the song I Am the Walrus. The walrus is a death omen to the Vikings. I mean, it wasn't, not at all.
No.
And I think somewhere along the line, there's also We Are the Eggmen or something. It's all very, very strange.
Oh, Dave, it's endless. Can I say a couple of things about this? If you're interested in wacky Beatle rumours, there is a book called The Walrus Was Ringo, written by a guy called Alan Clayson, who's, I think, written more books about the Beatles than anybody else. And it is wall to wall with these kind of rumours. I mean, and they're rumours, right? Secondly, if there's substance to what we're talking about tonight, not substance in the sense that Paul McCartney was replaced by an imposter, but if there's stuff to be learned, it is about how people come to believe these things. And you know, my argument would be that we see it done differently in the internet now. People get into, as they call it, silos and wind each other up. But a lot of this was done informally in the past by older people winding younger people up, basically. You know, and I would suggest that in a very simplistic way, a combination of soft drugs, convivial evenings around a stereo, you can persuade people to certain things. And there's all sorts of rumours relating to that. And that certainly, to my mind, fuels a lot of the Paul McCartney rumour. And like I said earlier, it's the late 1960s, 1969, the music industry had never seen anything quite like it. When the new Beatles album climbed the charts, it was followed by its immediate predecessors, yeah? And the received wisdom in the music industry was that albums just simply didn't do that. They didn't come back up the charts again when the new one came out. Now, we'll never know how many copies of the White Album or Sgt. Pepper were destroyed as people tried to, you know, just listen to that little fragment again. But we haven't got time to go into it. But if you Google this, particularly to do with Paul, there are loads of lyrical clues and there are loads of clues in the sounds. And the best way to hear them is to play them backwards. I mean, who the hell sorted this? Who the hell realized this in the first place? I don't know. And of course, in 1969, it was not easy to listen to music backwards. Just as an aside, and then I'll take another question. If you want to hear the best backward mask in music industry history, in my humble opinion, let's forget the Beatles for a second. It's on a song called Find the Answer Within by a band called the Boo Radleys. You listen to the song, there is blatantly a bit of backward vocal in it. When you play it backwards, in the middle of this song, the Boo Radleys are all singing in perfect harmony. They're singing the jingle from the Club Biscuits commercial. In the middle of another song, they all sing, "If you like a lot of chocolate on your biscuit, join our club." Wonderful, yeah?
Oh, that's fabulous.
Yeah, that's it's interesting because it's relevant here in as much as it is blatantly a backward mask where other people claim to be happening on them. There's no doubt. The second you hear that, it is clearly a backward vocal. And from the second they released it, they made it obvious what it was. And you know, radio played the song accord. I mean, it it did them favours. It got played on Radio 1 quite a lot because a lot of people thought it funny at the time, but it's over two decades ago now, so people don't know about it.
That's brilliant. I've not heard that one. Loz, are you there? Laurie? Okay, well, Loz is...
Sorry, I was just typing about the club song.
Oh, okay. Loz is a bit of a teacher's pet, I've decided. I didn't know.
No, I just, when you said that, I realised that there was a bit of a link with the club advert because Jane Asher was in that advert and she was the ex-fiancée of Paul McCartney.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She was surrounded by kids in that advert. I remember them singing. I don't know why I remember that. I was a kid at the time. I guess it stuck in my head.
Oh, that's interesting. I mean, that might not be coincidental because if you've only got to listen to about two or three Boo Radley songs to realise that they are massive Beatles fans.
Yeah, I do remember the Boo Radleys. So, they're a Britpop band, weren't they?
Yeah, exactly. So that might not... You know what? Thank you for that because I hadn't realised that. And you're right. It may well be that there's a circumstantial Beatle link, which they were very... that if they decided to do a backward mask, it might be, yeah, there might be that Beatle link. I hadn't thought about that. Thank you.
Sorry, you were saying about, was Paul referring to Paul being in the walrus costume?
Yeah, it was a response to Dave's comment about the walrus. And I said, sort of in line with what you were saying earlier about hints being in lyrics and things, and a later comment that I made regarding, you know, if there were rumours like that going around about me, I'd quite like to have a bit of a poke and a bit of a joke and try and perpetuate it a little bit. So there's a song on, I think it's the White Album, called Glass Onion, which has a lyric called, which goes, "The walrus was Paul."
Yeah.
Which obviously refers to the fact that if you look at the Iron the Walrus video, Paul is wearing the walrus costume, but also it could refer to, you know, the walrus, death, Paul is dead, so sort of perpetuating it anyway.
It is, yeah, absolutely. So one thing to say on that, Loz, that number one, Glass Onion makes it obvious that the Beatles were aware of their own mythology and were having fun with it. A character I haven't mentioned, and I'll keep this brief, but somebody who was central to the Paul is dead rumour perpetuating itself was Derek Taylor, who was the Beatles' publicist.
Yeah.
And crudely, this happened because when the rumour really took hold in 1969, it'd been around since 1967, when the rumour really took hold in 1969, Paul was unavailable. The Beatles' Apple office was receiving loads of calls from worldwide media about it, and Derek Taylor was fielding them, and he realised very quickly that it was just generating publicity, and it was selling records. And he was the publicist. So he was well aware of the mythology. The Beatles clearly were aware of this. And, you know, that certain things that they were also aware that certain things had happened that had fueled it. Without going into too much detail, an uncanny, unbelievable thing, but this is you'll find this in various marginal corners of the internet. Paul McCartney owned a unique car. Paul McCartney had a car that was made for him by BMC, British Motor Company at the time, which subsequently became British Leyland. He had a unique Mini, and it just wasn't that unique, but I mean, it had bits and pieces of trim and stuff. It was quite a well-known car around St. John's Wood. And improbably, the car was involved in an accident, which is one of the reasons why there's a belief that he died in a road accident in January 1967. And what is unbelievable but true about it is that the guy driving the car at the time wasn't Paul McCartney. It was a guy called Mohammed Chalibi, who was a kind of go-to and a fixer for the rich rock star setting in London. And amongst other things, this guy was involved in art galleries and stuff, but one of the things that he used to do occasionally when various rock stars were heading off for the weekend to party, like at Keith Richards' house, Redlands in Surrey, Sussex is it, I can't remember, but anyway, when they were heading down there, often somebody else would carry the drugs, and this guy was one of them, and it just so happened he was driving Paul McCartney's Mini and carrying a bit of contraband, and he crashed it. But what is unbelievable but true about it is that the guy bore such a resemblance to Paul McCartney, although he was a North African, he'd got the same Beatle haircut and a moustache that Paul McCartney had in 1967. And this is borne out by the fact that occasionally when he arrived at Paul McCartney's house, which was always surrounded by Beatle fans, people would see him come in and scream. And it was only when he got closer that they realised they were screaming at the wrong guy. So the point is, various circumstantial things were happening that were feeding a myth. People like Derek Taylor were well aware of this, and they chose wisely, from a business point of view, not to comment, because it was all just fueling the rumour mill. And when the band weren't touring, but they still wanted to be in the public eye, it was doing them no harm in terms of sales.
Fabulous. Just before we move on, Neil, I know you want to move on to Ringo soon. And before we move on to a couple of George comments, can I just, I have to confess here and now, I'm not a Beatles fan and I don't know anything about music, but I did like Tony Hayes' comments here. Paul McCartney's bass guitar technique has been consistent throughout, which is as good as a fingerprint. It's impossible to duplicate. So to someone who can get to do that, a left-hand player, and look identical at the same time, is a tough ask. Plus his songwriting skills have remained the same. Therefore, he's very much alive. What do you think of that?
Oh, look, completely. I'm presenting you with evidence of how urban legends come about and why they might take off and why they might not. So the Paul and the George stories, for example, are instructive because effectively it's the same story supported by the same evidence, but one of them is widely known and one of them isn't. Yeah, of course it's Paul McCartney. Look, seriously, kidnap somebody who bears a resemblance to a rock star on the street, take them home and see if they can perform.
That's very good idea.
Unlikely, all right? And yes, of course he's Paul McCartney, and George Harrison was George Harrison, all right?
And Mark Norman, are you there, Mark?
I am.
Where you say the slide just looks like George Harrison's a cult leader, is that the one sitting on the bench?
Yes. The one that was shot outside the house that wasn't George's house, and the previous slide. They just look to me like, it's not for any intentional purposes, I don't think, but they just made me think this is a bit like watching David Koresh or somebody like that.
Oh, possibly, yeah. I mean, there's absolutely no doubt. The shot on the inner sleeve of the Material World album is clearly a pastiche of the Leonardo's Last Supper, right?
Mm.
George Harrison had a bit of a thing about Catholicism. There's a really good song on his final album, the one that was released posthumously, Brainwashed, called Vatican P2 Blues, where, amongst other things, he pretends that Cardinal Marcinkus is playing a slide guitar solo. And he has loaded... There's a song on the All Things Must Pass album where... The early version of it, he makes a comment about something like the Pope owns 51% of General Motors, so the prices on the stock exchange are all he's really qualified to quote us. So he's having a dig at Catholicism, yeah. And it's a theme in his work. I mean, obviously he grew up in a Christian country and he embraced an Eastern religion, so it was something that mattered a lot to him.
Brilliant. Are we going to move on to Ringo now?
We are indeed, yes. Yeah. So a last little coda then. Okay. Should we agree that Ringo's alive? I think that's probably a good place to start.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so you've got to be careful. You can't throw things at me. So if there's any big Beatles fans out there, I sometimes make the quip about... he's late for the reunion on the other side then, but then he's, you know, you might want to say about Ringo that his timing wasn't his strong point, which I don't believe, actually, but people have criticised Ringo's drumming, which I think is unfair. Truth of the matter, the one common belief about Ringo Starr is that he just got lucky, yeah? Because Pete Best was the drummer with the Beatles and they decided to sack Pete, largely on the basis that he wasn't like the rest of them, and they got Ringo starring instead. Therefore, Ringo didn't do the hard yards with the early Beatles, albeit he did do them with Rory Storm and the Hurricanes. But this is true. On the 15th of August 1962, Paul and George went to Butlins in Skegness, where Rory Storm and the Hurricanes were playing a season, and they offered Ringo 10 bob a week more than he was getting with Rory Storm and the Hurricanes to join the Beatles. So in 1962, he basically got 50 pence a week more. But that was significant money. I mean, certainly from, you know, the days of a jobbing musician around that time. And what they wanted from Ringo was not they weren't, obviously they had no idea how successful they were going to be. They were just vying to be the best band in Liverpool at the time, and one of the other contenders were Rory Storm and the Hurricanes. So the you could, if you went to the Cavern Club in 1962, not that I ever did, but if you went to the Cavern Club in 1962, you might, over a drink, have an argument with somebody about whether Rory Storm and the Hurricanes, King Size Taylor and the Dominoes, or the Beatles were the best group. The Beatles were on the rise. They'd done a good session in Hamburg, but King Size Taylor and the Dominoes were probably selling more tickets on a regular basis. So the Beatles went to get the drummer from Rory Storm and the Hurricanes for three reasons. Number one, they thought he could add more to their stage presence. There was a moment in the Rory Storm set called Star Time where Ringo would come forward and sing a song, which is not the kind of thing that Pete Best was ever going to do. So they effectively added to their ability to entertain by adding Ringo Starr. Okay. Secondly, it was clearly in their interests to disable to a certain extent one of their main rivals in Liverpool, right? And thirdly, they just liked Ringo. You know, it was enough of a small musical community in Liverpool that the various bands that played the Cavern and the other venues in the place knew each other and knew what breaks each other were getting, like, you know, when they were going out to Hamburg and the rest of it. So the Beatles simply liked Ringo. When they decided to get rid of Pete Best, it wasn't a decision that we've got to get Ringo, therefore Pete's got to go. The decision, the biographies agree on this, that to a certain extent, Pete Best, their then drummer, was, there were reasons that they wouldn't want to hang on to him, to do with the fact that he was less like, he didn't fully share the sense of humour, the famous sense of humour that the other three had. Pete's usefulness in the early days revolved a lot around his mum Mona, the money that she had, the access, she had run a cafe. So amongst other things, it was useful in as much as she'd been able to fork out for a drum kit for Pete, and also she'd been able to help him to find places to rehearse. By August of 1962, they were big enough not to be reliant on that kind of help. So it was a two-part decision. Pete had to go, therefore they needed a new drummer. The best available when they thought about all the options was Ringo. So the common belief about Ringo is that he got lucky. Yeah, they bought him in on the basis of effectively giving him a quarter as much money again. And the rest of it, he was just in the right place at the right time. I would disagree. In fact, when my book on the Beatles, the Beatles Myths and Legends book, came out, the liveliest radio interview I did by a country mile was with a guy called Billy Butler, who was a presenter on BBC Radio Merseyside and something of a local legend. And Billy Butler was so steeped in the Beatles that he'd been one of the regulars at the Cavern, and he'd seen all these Mersey beat bands. And he'd been one of the fans who turned up and protested when the Beatles sacked Pete Best. Pete was very popular with Beatle fans, and the girls in particular liked him. In fact, they thought he was better looking. A lot of the female fans thought he was better looking than the other three. And if you're playing in a place like the Cavern, which is tiny, it doesn't matter which Beatle you're looking at. If you fancy them, you're close enough almost to touch them. And Billy Butler was not impressed with my rant about Ringo. There's a bit in the book called The Ringo Rant, which I won't bore you with the whole thing, but it's 10 reasons why Ringo is an absolutely wonderful human being, and therefore why any rumour, any belief that Ringo is lucky is just misguided, right? Okay, I will give you a greatest hits, therefore, of The Ringo Rant. First of all, Ringo didn't get lucky. The Beatles got lucky to get Ringo, and it's easily equal, right? The Beatles had their greatest success from the mid-60s up to the present day. They're probably bigger in America than they ever were in the UK, right? America has treated them almost like gods, basically. And one of the reasons for that is that before they could play everywhere in America, bear in mind, they went over there in 1964. Stadium rock didn't exist. The amplification and stuff that was available then just wasn't good enough. we forget how much the Beatle films made a difference to selling the Beatles to the world, and particularly A Hard Day's Night, which was made on a shoestring because nobody expected that the band was going to be, nobody would have expected in 1964 that Hard Day's Night, nearly 60 years old, would still be regarded as one of the best rock films ever. It was a cheap cash in. And pretty much the only time in that entire movie that they really push it into dramatic acting is a famous scene where Ringo is by the Serpentine, and he's the best Beatle actor, end of, right? It's a mournful little scene, but it was absolutely pivotal to the success of the Beatles, because it was a moment when it was Richard Lester, who directed the movie, realized he'd got a proper actor on his hand, and he could do something with Ringo, and actually you could do something with the other Beatles. And if you were going to make more movies, these could play around America. Everybody could see them. The Beatles would never play in the Midwest or all these little hick towns and stuff like that. And Ringo in particular, his acting performance in A Hard Day's Night won over a lot of mums in America. I won't bore you with all the ins and outs, but there are Beatle tribute records that came out around the time that the Beatles got big in America. And quite a lot of them are dedicated to Ringo. He was the character, particularly if you saw the movie, that came over very, very strongly, because he's a really good actor. And he's not made the most of his acting skills. He has been cast in lead roles in more movies than any other Beatle. His alcoholism didn't do his acting career any favours. And I would suggest if you go and investigate Ringo acting, you avoid movies like Caveman, where he's drunk on set most of the time. On the other hand, if you've not seen That'll Be the Day, an early 1970s movie which sets itself in and around the beat groups of the early 1960s, it's a starring vehicle for David Essex. But Ringo, who is the second lead in that movie, is absolutely brilliant. He's almost playing the character he would have been had he not been Ringo Starr. He works on a fairground with David Essex, and he's a teddy boy, and he's wonderful. Yeah. Don't believe, in my humble opinion anyway, you shouldn't believe the rumours you hear about Ringo not being a great drummer. He wasn't only wanted by the Beatles. Another thing that the Beatles did by signing Ringo Starr was that, the biographies all agree on this, king-size Taylor, who arguably was the biggest musical act in Liverpool before the Beatles got bigger than he did, king-size Taylor wanted Ringo as well. Ringo was a very good live drummer. He was entertaining, he could keep the beat, and not only that, but he was quite responsive to the people around him, all right? The Beatles relied on Ringo a lot because when things got absolutely insane in terms of their fan hysteria and stuff like that, Ringo repeatedly was the most grounded Beatle, right? It's been discussed recently, the Get Back movie, about the breakup of the Beatles, okay? Because the news, in inverted commas, of the Disney TV series was that when you see all the footage from the abortive sessions, they actually get on quite well. There's a lot of the camaraderie there, which is not in the original Let It Be movie. But people discuss the breakup of the Beatles, and it's widely, the shorthand version is that the Beatles broke up when Paul McCartney said he was leaving. But actually, if anything, he was the last Beatle to leave. The first one to leave was Ringo. In 1968, he legged it out of the double white sessions because he was getting fed up with all the bickering. He went and stayed on Peter Sellers' yacht for a couple of weeks because he'd got to know Peter Sellers through filming a movie called The Magic Christian, where, again, he performs really well. It was a wake-up call to the Beatles. Ringo came back to find his drums covered in flowers because he was the one who said, no, this is we're the Beatles. We've just got to work at this. And they realised, and the flowers all over his drums was like his mate saying, sorry, we were out of order. Yeah, you're right. And that's a significant little observation, because if you think that the implications, if the band had broken up at that point, there would have been no double white, there'd have been no Abbey Road. A lot of the basis of the Beatles legend would never have existed. All right. And as they got more musically demanding, Ringo's drumming holds up. I mean, one advantage that we've got these days is that when people release all these bonus albums with all the outtakes and stuff like that, you can hear them, particularly on the Abbey Road sessions, you can hear them piecing together the little fragments that make up that entire sidelong sequence of songs on Abbey Road. And Ringo's drumming on some of the more soulful and slow things is great. Absolutely great, right? He was very much a kind of down-to-earth guy. You know, he's the egg and chips thing there. He maintained for many years in fan interviews that that was his favourite meal. You know, it was almost like you could take him out of Liverpool, but you could never take Liverpool out of him. So he very much held the Beatles together in terms of keeping the reality there when the others were going off on flights of fancy. And I suppose if you're familiar with Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young, it's a similar dynamic in a way that a lot of people might suggest that Graham Nash is the slightest musical figure of that particular foursome, but the other three are agreed on about one thing, that he's the glue that held that band together for many years. And in fact, the Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young are over, it would appear, despite the fact that improbably they're all still alive, mainly because Graham Nash's best friend David Crosby, well, they've fallen out, and without Graham Nash holding the band together, there's no hope that they'll ever get back together. Ringo played a very similar role with the Beatles, all right? If you want to argue about his drumming, I mean, we could do that all night, and that's not why we're here, but I would respectfully suggest that if you just listen to his performance on the Plastic Ono Band album, some of which is recorded with three musicians, Klaus Voormann, John Lennon, and Ringo Starr all in the same room. He's brilliant. He's absolutely brilliant. He's not a Keith Moon kind of drummer. He's a very deft and soulful drummer, right? And not only that, but he's very easy to underestimate as a talent. I'm not going to sit here and argue that he's a great vocalist, but interestingly, he clearly is somebody who's driven to make great music, apart from anything else. Obviously, there's only two surviving Beatles, but Ringo is actually more prolific than Paul in terms of the records he releases, okay? But also, he has been the subject of certain rumours. There is a website called Jew or Not Jew, and amongst other things, they assess... It's semi-humorous, but they look at people in the public eye and, you know, they discuss whether they're actually Jewish or not. Ringo Starr in certain photographs appears very Jewish. He's not, and there's no Jewish ancestry. It's just coincidental. But it's interesting, Jew or not Jew actually quoted, this is from their site, you know, yeah. He's not, but they give him a Jew score of 8 out of 10 in terms of circumstantial resemblance to the Jewish qualities that they're looking for. And then they note that it's sad, really, because we take Ringo. It's not like we can have John, Paul or George. That said, he's married to somebody who's half Jewish. So that's one of the reasons why his score goes up a little bit. An improbable marriage, actually, if you think that, you know, two celebrities who went to rehab together, and it's the longest marriage of any Beatle. Ringo and Barbara Bach have been married 41 years this year, right? But there's a serious side to this. Ringo was actually subject of a death threat in the 1960s. Ringo actually performed a gig in Montreal because he was about to be killed by anti-Semites who thought he was Jewish. And that actually happened. A detective crouched beside his drum kit throughout the whole show. I don't think there's a recording of that. And actually, early 1960s recordings of the Beatles are not great because you can't hear them for the screaming. But apparently a detective was prepared to take a bullet for him. Probably... I've Googled to try and find the name of the detective and what the hell happened to him and how true that story is, but you can't actually find the name of it. But that definitely did happen. Okay. So let's just have a little bit of a diversion into another belief, and then we'll take the last lot of questions here. A couple of things to say about this. In the 1970s up to 1980, there is a belief among some people that the Beatles recorded under assumed names. The Beatles have never actually split up. There is so much Beatle business to do that there is a Beatles to this day. Legally speaking, there is a four-person group out there. It's just that if you put them on stage, I don't know that anybody would pay to see them perform, because obviously it includes Olivia Harrison and Yoko Ono at this point. But the Beatles never actually legally, from the point of view of business, ever split up. So they were all in touch with each other. So you could see why the rumours would start. But there are three bands that whose career for one reason or another was mistaken for the Beatles, in one case deliberately so, because they set out to be mistaken for the Beatles. The first one is The Residents. So top right hand corner, you're looking at the Meet the Residents album. The Residents are a willfully weird band, to say the least, avant-garde. And one of the things about The Residents was that they never performed live for years. They always hid behind pseudonyms. So certainly before the age of the internet, it was impossible to know who The Residents were. They just made music and stuck it out. And it was very, very avant-garde music. But they flirted with a Beatles-style album cover, and it did lead some gullible people to think that it was actually the Beatles. But as I've put in the brackets there, right, if that was the Beatles, they'd put Yoko in charge of musical direction, because The Residents owe as much to Yoko Ono as they do to the Beatles. I won't go and drag it off the... I was playing the Loving Awareness album earlier on today. This is probably the least known of the ones that were widely believed at the time. Loving Awareness was a band put together to make the album Loving Awareness. It was promoted on Radio Caroline. One of the people behind it was Ronan O'Reilly, who was the head of Radio Caroline at the time. And the artwork on the Loving Awareness album, particularly on the front, aped the graphics of the Beatles. And the whole point of it was to create an album in 1976 that sounded like it was the Beatles. That is not an accident of typing on there when I call them a bunch of blockheads. Some of the members of Loving Awareness went on to be Ian Dury's blockheads, but they actually created an album. And Radio Caroline were careful to announce playing it as if, you know, as if everybody knew. They just said, oh, yeah, Beatles Loving Awareness, and they dropped the word Beatles in when they were discussing it. It was a kind of, you know, something of a joke the way that they did it, but one or two people fell for it. The other band that are well known as potential Beatles were Klaatu, named after the character in the film The Day the Earth Stood Still. So there's a circumstantial link to the Beatles in one sense, that if you've seen Ringo Starr's Goodnight Vienna album, Ringo Starr is dressed up as the character Klaatu. The Goodnight Vienna album is a pastiche of a film still from The Day the Earth Stood Still. Ringo Starr is Klaatu in the picture. So there's a circumstantial link to it. But basically, I put there, I do this when I'm doing this talk live, you know, any sound hounds in the house. A lot of people have heard of the band Klaatu if they know their music inside out. Very few people can name them. They're Canadians. They played live, but they were a band that were better known for their music than who they were. So they were anonymous, like say a band like Boston or something. You know, the band was the branding, and the individuals, they didn't have a star member, basically. That's the first Klaatu album. Some people did genuinely believe it was the Beatles. A rumour went round to that effect. If you're unfamiliar with that record, you're probably familiar with a song called Calling Occupants of an Interplanetary Craft, which was performed by the Carpenters, but it's actually a cover version of a song that's on that album. A little aside, and then we'll get to sort of finishing this up, but that was the 1970s. Rumours would go around. The internet and stuff wasn't there to both fuel the rumors but also to give you reality checks. More recently, when I wrote that Beatles book and I was looking for sort of belief about songs and, you know, people that were being mistaken for other people, it happens all the time these days, because obviously people access playlists these days, and there's a lot of common misconceptions. It's widely believed, particularly by Americans, that Don't Worry Be Happy is a Bob Marley song, for example. And quite a lot of people, one of the songs most commonly mistaken for a Beatles song that isn't these days is Mr. Blue Sky by the ELO. So it still goes on, right? And it will go on indefinitely, because the Beatles are still a massive cultural force. So this is a combination of past and present Beatle culture, basically. You know, you've got Beatle branded socks there, which that's an internet advert that because I had a Beatles page running for a while on Facebook, I used to get bombarded with Beatle-related adverts, including one for those socks, right? On the top right there, that's a fairly recent compilation album of covers of the Beatles. That's a fairly recent picture of John Lennon's old Rolls-Royce. that's a fairly recent picture of what happens day in, day out on the Abbey Road zebra crossing. People line up. The other two at the bottom there, the inflatable Beatles and the sing-along Beatles record with the really, really ropey backing tracks. I wouldn't recommend it. That's Beatles memorabilia from the height of the Beatles' own fame, right? Okay. So the Beatles, anything's possible then. Okay, I mentioned about Mr. Blue Sky, all right? I'll play you a couple of more clips of sound again. Is this or is this not the Beatles? Tell you for free, neither of those are the Beatles, but they're both united by one thing, that those are songs that have appeared as the Beatles. So the third song I played you, the Candle Burns, is a song that's turned up on Beatle bootlegs. This one is interesting. Sorry, my bad. The first one of those you heard there, the writing on the wall thing, it's a song called Have You Heard the Word by a band called The Foot. The Foot weren't really a band. They included a guy called Billy Lurie, who was most famous as somebody who hung around the music business quite a bit, but he's Lulu's brother. The Lennon-esque vocal, which is a very convincing vocal, but he's not John Lennon, is actually Maurice Gibb of the Bee Gees. And what's interesting about this song is the second bullet point there. In 1985, that song had appeared on so many Beatle bootlegs that Yoko Ono, unable to discover who the hell it was, copyrighted it for Len Ono Music, which is the publishing company that handled her and John Lennon. And it's not. If John Lennon had been alive, he would have been able to point out to her that it's not one of his songs. But she'd heard it on bootlegs and she was briefly convinced. She copyrighted it. And it obviously, subsequently, it's come to light. It's a drunken session involving members of the band The Sorrows, Billy Lurie and Maurice Gibb, who just happened to be in the same studio, and they just did that, and it sounded so like the Beatles. And you can now pick it up on compilation albums. The other one, the song Lies, has also turned up on many Beatle bootlegs, but it's widely known now that that's an American band called Knickerbockers, who were one of the American groups that emerged, so-called garage bands of the period, who emerged in the wake of the Beatles. And that song is actually quite well known, and it's on a number of compilations, the most famous of which is a compilation called Nuggets, which is an absolute go-to box of treasures about garage bands. But both of those tracks have appeared on Beatles bootlegs, and in the days before the internet, when you could check this stuff out, there were quite a lot of people who were convinced it was both of those were the Beatles, including, like I say, in 1985, Yoko Ono, right? And they are the gift that keeps on giving, because there are still things to be discovered. There are still things that are unknown about the Beatles, all right? Top bullet point there, in 1971, a journalist called Martin Lewis in the music paper Disc in the UK did a comprehensive article about the Beatles. And as he thought for a joke, he listed four Beatles songs that were unreleased at the time: Deck Chair, Colliding Circles, Left is Right and Right is Wrong, and Pink Litmus Paper Shirt, describing all the songs. So Colliding Circles was a bit of psychedelic folk by Lennon. Left is Right and Right is Wrong was the whole band just having a bit of a mess around. Deck Chair was a 1920s pastiche by Paul McCartney and Pink Litmus Paper Shirt was a bit of psychedelia by George Harrison. Now, there is still known to be unreleased Beatle material. The prize at the moment, i.e. the most conspicuously unavailable Beatle material, is a thing called the Isha Demos, which is the band rehearsing and trying out ideas for what would eventually become tracks on the White Album, and also some tracks that, like a song called Sour Milk Sea that subsequently came out, a George Harrison song that was recorded by, I think it was, I can't remember actually, Jackie Lomax might have recorded it, but Harrison recorded it as well. So there's still stuff out there, right? But the problem is, in terms of establishing the absolute truth of the Beatles, the culture around them keeps on going. So this is a single I was given recently for the radio show that I do, and, you know, it just turned up in a bunch of other stuff. But the second I saw the title of it, I thought, nah. And it's not a Harrison song, obviously. It's somebody getting on the back of that rumour, and Strange Turner, a psychedelic band who were greatly inspired by the Beatles. So Pink Litmus Paper Shirt was never a George Harrison song, but it's almost like people are reimagining it these days as if it was. So Strange Turn performed it as if it had been an original George Harrison song. Well, just, if I can hit the right bit, we'll have a listen to it.
Strange things are happening to me. I feel like Salvador Dali. My heart is broken, but it still hurts beneath my pink litmus paper shirt. My pink litmus paper shirt.
All right, okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Neil. That was on behalf of ASSAP, that was a brilliant talk. I think all of us, regardless of whether we love the Beatles music or not, it was absolutely fascinating, to be honest. And I think we may have heard some of the Beatles rumours before, but you've certainly put some of them to bed and maybe raised a few questions about some of the others. And we definitely have a lot of questions about the individual members of the Beatles that you've raised.
Okay.
David Rolfe, are you there? You there? Nope.
Hi, yeah, sorry, let me just...
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. You were saying about George Harrison, with most of his songs being pretty spiritual, and you don't think he was scared of death. I definitely agree with you on that. Do you want to expand on that bit?
Yeah, I could. Definitely not, because when Jeffrey Abrahams attacked George Harrison in his home just before the turn of the millennium, it's an interesting story about why George Harrison survived it. Bear in mind, this was somebody who'd broken into George Harrison's house with the intention of killing him. He stabbed George Harrison and definitely endangered his life. And at the moment that was happening, it again widely reported, George Harrison started chanting Hare Krishna. He was ready to go. The reason he survived was because his much more pragmatic wife grabbed a table lamp and hit the guy in the head. So if you saw photographs of Jeffrey Abrahams afterwards, he's got quite a lot of damage on his